Right, well, next we want to move from the kind of level of models and theory, illuminated with some great little anecdotes, I think, from Harold, into how might some of this stuff actually play out on the ground. And Drew and I, over the years, have developed some workshop methods, particularly informed by Drew's expertise in developing games. And that led us to invent the London Borough of Slipham, which is a fictitious but realistic place populated with the sort of characters and organisations that you, I'm sure, might recognise, with a map of their existing relationships, or lack of relationships, to provide a kind of backcloth in which one could explore how to apply some of these kinds of models in practice. Drew, do you want to pick it up from there?
What we'll do is, I'll show a few slides and run up to this, but then we've got an exercise to run you through where you actually play with something, okay? I'll do this fairly quickly because I left my charger on the train coming down last night, so this might run out halfway through. Just to pick up on harmless points, actually, this is something we did for a group that formed men in London some years ago, what they called networkistas, people who are interested in the whole business of network relationships, network analysis, etc., since, I think, they found. Well, we developed ideas really four types of person that was interested in the idea of networks, network analysis, that kind of thing. And they go from the network thinkers, plenty of books about how important networks are, yeah? And they might be applied to all sorts of fields, economics, sociology, epidemiology, cell biology, there's lots of stuff like that. You know, the idea, the perspective of networks is being explored. But they don't tell you very much about how to actually handle that stuff on the ground. There's network analysts who know the theory of networks and can work the software and the way of representing networks in order for you to be able to say, yeah, that's the sort of network ecology within which I'm working, and here's why we may be able to manipulate that in various ways. That might suit the kind of purposes you have as a person working for a community or whatever. So they know about the concepts and the maps, and kind of how networks work. There's the networker, and basically conferences are just stuff that's, you know, stuff full of this. You all go to the bar afterwards, you all form new relationships, you exchange cards, etc., and you expand your own personal network. But what networkers are doing is they're forming their own list of contacts. And it's only when you put together lots of people's lists of contacts that you start to understand how the network is working. Right? So when somebody says, I've got this great network of contacts, they don't have a network, they've got a list. And then there's the network builder, or the network weaver, or whatever, who's the important person, who's trying to stick together the relationships between people who are not connected at the moment. They're not trying to expand their network, they're trying to expand their network as a whole. Does that make sense? This is supposed to be the bridge between what you were doing, right?
Okay.
I'm just going to run through very quickly some what we're doing in, we have been doing in Croydon. It's not a very great slide here, that's one. But what this shows is a network of organisations, community groups, and key individuals in the London Borough of Croydon. This is collected as part of an investigation into a whole series of ABCD pilots, asset-based community development pilots. We collect lots of information about what were the key organisations, how they're related to each other. And this was done through phone survey, through online survey, through events, through interviews, a whole stack of different ways of trying collect that information. But what you can do with this software is you can take any one of those You can see that there's a node there with a little red ring around it. Not great resolution of this, but that's the family centre in Fieldway is on there. And what the software will do is you can hold stacks of information about that node in the software. So it's not just a way of representing networks, it's a way of holding a whole database of information about the members of that network. And you can do the same with the links as well, which tell the story of why they're linking. So you start to get a tool that can really tell you about who's on the network, how they're connected to each other, and we can put lots of medical information into that as well. We can then search that network in lots of complex ways. So you start to feel your way around the network. And the thing about networks represented this way is, if you think of the first time you ever saw a spreadsheet, oh my God, that's just so complicated. But you gradually learn to read spreadsheets. And it's the same with networks. Gradually you learn to read a network. So you can have some idea of the way it's working from the patterns that are formed there. And the software then really helps them. Okay. We've also looked at this is the work we did for the Centre for Ageing Better. Now this is coming down from the local level, the Croydon stuff, to look at a family network. So this is looking at Mary, who's the larger node on this side. The size of nodes represents how central they are to that system. That's actually calculated by the software. That's not something that I've said, she's most central. It's something the software will calculate because of the patterns, who's most central. So as a husband, Bob, most of our immediate friendships are through Bob's relationship with his place of work, and then she has made his family connections. But what we can also do is we can step through that in terms of time. So let's move on now, 5 years. Bob's dead, poor old Bob, and what's happened is that many of her connections with the place he worked in have disappeared. But she's decided to form new connections through joining a walking club and a bowling club. So she's got clusters of friends now forming around that. We've got another 5 years. She really loses those residual connections to her husband's place of work. Unfortunately, 5 years later, her arthritis is too bad for continuing the walking club. She misses that. The important point here is that although social prescribing might say, yes, you should join organisations that keep you fit and healthy and walking, etc., if all of a sudden you can't do that, you lose quite a lot of the friends that are associated with that activity. And that's something we explored with the temporary advisor. And the last one is Mary's back to her immediate family, pretty much a few friends, but the percentage of organisations that have a say with Mary now, through Marta, who's a carer, Dr. Harris, Dr. Thompson, is far larger than it was before. We were certainly interested at looking at how networks change between late middle age and older age. So what we were exploring there is using this as a tool for on-the-ground workers to actually use in mapping the way that families develop over time. We're doing some other work in Scotland for an organisation called the Children Parliament, but we can actually start looking at that at the other end of the spectrum. So we're looking at the way that family relationships develop for younger children. So what I'm really trying to say here is that it's not the software that's important here, it's just the way of looking at stuff. That looking at stuff as a network gives you certain perspectives and certain insights into the way the things happen or may develop in the future. Right. This is the London Borough of Slipham. What we've done here is to take a whole series of organisations I've kind of accrued over the years. The very first time we ran Slipham was as a game for a body called Community Matters, you know, which I presume you may know. we did it for the National Conference. And what they particularly wanted to look at is how can you share assets between various organisations, you know, at the local level. So we invented Slipham, and it was a sharing game. If we take any one of the organisations within Slipham, my question on that, that indicates the special problem police, taking advantage from their website, social community services, some community partnership, it's a fictitious organisation, you can see all the information about it there. But what I wanted to do is to concentrate on these bits of information here. What we can do in any one of those nodes is to list the resources and skills that that node controls and something, right? So these are the things that we may be willing to share or not. We also have an idea of how technically literate that organisation or group might be, which is not very much in this case, and their willingness to share, which is terrible. We want to score between 1 and 5. And this gives us a way of being able to play with the information.
Yeah. Do you show what level they ought to have for their
footprint? So
do you show what level of skills they ought to have, given their function?
What we'll be doing is, what you will be doing a bit later on, is actually looking at how they might share these skills with other organisations, or borrow skills from other organisations, in order to improve the way they work. Because what I'm looking at constantly in these situations is there's no more resources, there's no more money coming out of the system. But there's two things. Firstly, it makes it more imperative that organisations should share, but it actually often makes organisations very reluctant to share. They fought for that budget. The last thing they ought to do is give stuff away to other people. So it's, anyway, remember, this is you know, obviously, there's huge complexities in here that we're not modelling with this. If you look at the network map itself, the size of the node is an indication of how central it is. When you look at network analysis, there are various ways of calculating how central a node is to the map as a whole, or how central it might be to various parts of the map. If anybody wants to know more about that, I can give you lots of stuff about that. What the software will also do is it will cluster nodes that say these seem to hang together, not because of their own characteristics, but because of their position on the network. So what we're saying here is that networks have inherent characteristics that are not the characteristics of their nodes. But they're above that. That all makes sense. Right. Next question. How many people have drawn the network map in this room? I know there are. Yes, okay. Right. Some of you will have used Kumu. Anybody here use Kumu? Right. Kumu is a software that draws this. Kumu is free. It runs online. And if you want to draw your own network map, you can take out a Kumu account. It won't cost you anything, and you can draw your own maps. Right? And that's the best way to get to grips with this stuff, is actually just to play around with it. The other thing about Kumu is that I'm based in Edinburgh. I'm 400 miles away from the people I'm working with in Croydon. But I can see what they're doing, because it all runs online. So I can hang over the shoulder, right, and give advice, whether it's wanted or not, and they can ask me questions. And it's done on the map, because there's a whole conversation stream about non-technical. Okay, that's the way that we have represented Slipham for today. The other coin that we have is that red blobs are very willing to share all their stuff. Yellow blobs are So you get some kind of knowledge here. For instance, you know, the biggest blob on the map, in terms of its centrality to what's happening in the map as a whole, isn't very well to show stuff. But it's very, very central to the way that information or whatever will be passed to the network. And often what we're doing in this kind of analysis is we're taking a series of characteristics, you know, which could be various capabilities of organisations in the node, and we're comparing that with their position on the network. I'll give you an example, and then we'll get to the exercise. Some years ago, we did a study of Berwick-on-Tweed, the generation partnership in Berwick-on-Tweed. We draw this, we drew the maps like this, we analyse the maps, and by far the most central organisation in the map was Berwick Council, because it brokered a lot of the contacts at regional level down into community groups and stuff. Right? So it was very, very central in the map. It was totally useless. It didn't have the resources to do anything. It had very, very few skills, and that's mainly judged by people who were employed by it. Right? So, and in fact, now it doesn't exist because they reorganised the way that local authorities work up there. So you had this anomaly that the organisation that's meant to be leading this whole partnership to do regeneration doesn't have the resources to be able to take up that very, very central role. It's amazing how often that happens. I can give you plenty of other examples. Right. I think I've done my bit. You're going to do the work now. Huh? What we've done is to put the network map, one you see up there, onto a large sheet. And what we'd like each of the groups to do is to sit down and have a good look at that map. Huh? And just say, well, you know, is there anything missing from this map? We know there aren't many health organisations on this map, for instance. Probably should be more of those. But use your own experience, your own interest to say, well, things I would like to see on the map aren't there at the moment. Alright? Once you've done that, we'll give you another sheet. So we'd like you to invent some organisation. Give them the list is 1, 2, 3, 4, so a maximum of 4 organisations per group. Give it a name and description, indicate the kind of resources it has, that's the resources and skills, and give it some kind of score for technology. Make it up. I want you to be at your creative best. You just have to copy, it should be fine. Once you've done that, take the number, whatever the node, the number one node here, and we'd like you to take the node that's coded one here and just connect it to the other organisations you think could be connected to the map. We can also get you, if you wish, to connect up organisations that are on the map and aren't connected at one. So you want to start feeling your way visually into the map and seeing what further connections you need, and also to add new ones. Is that all really clear? It's kind of haze sort of in the room at the moment. It's okay, if any problems will come sort of out. There's your map.